So after skills, we have feats. Now, what feats are, they're basically the way you really customize your character. Skills is one way. These background traits will be another, but feats is the real big, a real big thing to help focus your character and what you want them to be. I've already chosen my two, but let's go in and real quick and show you what you have to work with. Again, with as a fighter, you get one bonus feat. And then if we'll go back to the actual classes page in the core rulebook, and you scroll down to the character advancement section, you'll find a chart. And this chart shows you how to advance your character, shows you how many experience points you'll need to jump to the next level, depending on whether your GM has you on the fast track or the slow track, etc. And it gives you your level-dependent bonuses. So first level, you get a feat. When you get to third level, you get your second feat. By that time, a fighter, this will be my fourth one because I'll have had two fighter bonus feats at that point. The other big one, the fourth level, you'll see you get to get a bonus in your ability score. So right now, my dexterity is a 19. I'll bump that up to 20 right when I get to fourth level. No question. But for now, we're just concerned with the first level feat. If you go to the core rulebook and find feats, you'll see this is a huge... Okay, well, first of all, there's different kinds. Combat, critical, item creation, meta magic. You'll see this list here, and it is huge. There, like, where do you start? I mean, it's kind of ridiculous, right? And it's good to browse it and get some ideas and look for cool things that sound good, but, man, you know, that takes a lot of time. Look, I'm trying to speed this up for you, so we're going to skip that. We're not going to read through things. And if you're building an archer, look, it goes on and on. Here's the definitions. If you're building an archer, there's one feat you want to take before you take anything else. Because as you notice, some of these feats here have what are called prerequisites. Let's scroll up. And a lot of the times it's, you know, you have to have like a certain class feature, like this is good for a cleric. Sometimes it's just another feat in itself. Sometimes it's an actual character level. But you'll see arcane armor training, can't do it without armor proficiency, and so on. Can't do augment summoning unless you already have the spell focus feat. So with archery, there's the big one, and it's point blank shot. Now, this is organized in alphabetical order, so for the most part, sometimes it's kind of a pain in the butt to follow. Point blank shot. Actually, it does kind of give you here, so that's good. You'll see that it's indented, these ones that are, that it's prerequisite for. And there's quite a few. If you go to the PFSRD and you search for their feat tree, which I have here, this I think is, this is good because it takes them from all the other books, because sometimes in the advanced player guide, like this feat here under over, Agile Maneuvers from the core rulebook, so it has actually combines the multiple books. That's the one downfall for this Paizo site, is that you have to go back and forth between these different books to find feats and stuff, and it takes forever. So when it comes to feats, I like to switch over to this one. And let me show you, when you go all the way down to the P's, to point blank shot, you'll see that there are way more feats listed after it here that aren't just in the core rulebook. You have from the Ultimate Combat book, the Advanced Player Guide, and so on. But yeah, point blank shot, that's the big one. What that does is it gives you a plus one to your attacks and damage as long as you're within 30 feet of your target. So as I said, I took that one. And then you can go a few different ways. You can increase your ability to shoot from a distance by taking far shot. And other ones, the one I really like, though, the first two I think you should probably go with would be precise shot or rapid shot. Precise shot is good because if you're shooting into melee, like say your buddy with the sword and shield is up in the orc's face and they're swinging on each other, if you want to shoot the orc, you're going to take a penalty. Well, with this feat, it'll reduce that. It'll take away that penalty. It's a -4 penalty, so that's pretty substantial.
So, yeah, it is.
So that's,
it's like a -4 or something.
Yeah, -4. Yeah. So that negates it. The other good one is rapid shot, which gives you an extra attack as long as your character stands in one place for his turn. And so this is where you choose. Do you want to take two shots every turn when you get a chance, or do you want to be a little more accurate if you're, you know, shooting people where your buddies are fighting them too? Both of them are good, and actually at second level, if I take this one now, I'll take this one at second level. Because they lead into other feats, but you can't really get them until, like, sixth level. So it doesn't really matter. By second level, you'll have both. If you're a human, one of the good things about humans are they get that extra feat at first level. So I would have all three right now. I wouldn't even worry about it. And so right now, we don't even really need to worry about, like, after second level or so is when you really have to think about where you're going to go from there. Like, if I was, like, to say, take dodge, which gives you an armor class bonus, which isn't bad, but then later on I find out, hey, I needed, you know, point blank shot earlier to get to the feat I want later on, you know, you're going to feel bad. So it is good to plan ahead on your feats, even though you're only building a first level character. All right. So now, again, I'm rambling. let me go back to the sheet here.
I'm trying not to interject too much just so that you can
oh no, feel free.
Stick to your guns. Oops. Here.
So yeah, here's the feats I took. I will enter them into my character sheet. Again, with this character sheet, you can put things where you want. I like to add my feats, well, here under feats and features.
I like to put my feats where the feats go.
It's late, man. All right. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I got you.
I also like to put a note in real quick as to when I got my feet. So point blank shot. And I'm typing slowly, sorry. Then maybe parentheses. Then 30 feet. All right. And after that, I'll put a fighter bonus one. And that's the precise shot. And I won't bother typing in a little note. I know what it does. All right. So moving on. We got our feats taken care of. We got our skills, got most of our class stuff done. So let's talk about the background traits. Background traits are a good way to give you little bonuses and as well as giving you a little bit of a backstory or helping you figure out your backstory. So back on the main page, where you're going to find these are actually in the Ultimate Campaign book. I think there's, like I said, I think there's a PDF you can download for free too that has just the traits in. There are nothing else. But go to character background. And here's some good reading on, you know, coming up with stuff for your character. But we're not really worried about doing that at the moment. We're going down here to the very bottom where you get a few things to click on. And we're going to traits. There are combat traits. There are faith traits. There are social traits for how, you know, your character is brought up. And again, you see there's quite a big list of them. Now traits, again, they're really nice. They're kind of like micro feats. And I like the one I almost always choose, it's hard not to, is reactionary. It's one of the combat traits. It says you were bullied as a child, so you've developed a quick response. It gives you a +2 bonus to your initiative. Since I'm an elf, I can still get that +2 initiative if I scroll all the way down here to the race traits. And I can give it a little bit of different flavor. It's the same mechanical bonus. Does nothing different. But warrior
of old.
Do
they stack?
No, they don't. I don't think they. Well, you know what? Maybe they do.
They're like, just... could you take both traits and then bam, you're starting with a +4 initiative?
You know bonus. What? I think you could. That's a
oh,
good.
Oh man,
that's a good point, Jared. Well, now you have me rethinking. I'll probably stick with what my original plan was. Basically, when you do traits, you pick two of them. So Warrior of Old is one I chose, and that's, like I said, You still get that +2 to your initiative. If you've never, again, if you haven't played Pathfinder before, initiative is at the beginning of every fight, you roll a 20-sided die, add your initiative bonus, and whoever has the highest scores goes first. So it's always good to go first. So that's why I pretty much always choose that. Warrior Vold, +2 initiative bonus. Yeah, it's good. It just means that you were, even as a child, you were going through combat drills, and it kind of fits with this guy's story where he was an archer in an elven army growing up and then decided to venture out on his own. So that one fits, Warrior Vold. Also, now, what I wanted to do is I wanted to beef up my will saves, because I had a character die once that I really liked because he had a shitty will save. And so, for me personally, I like to always beef that up. one thing
left
you do...
left a scar.
Yeah, it did. It did. Sometimes you can just do a quick little search. Even. There. Will saves. And you can scroll down and try to find something. And here's the one I had chose. Indomitable Faith. It gives you a +1 to your will saves, which is good. And a little bit more backstory, it says you were born into a region where your faith was not popular, but you never abandoned it. So I get a +1 on my wills from that. Now, like I said, you get to choose usually 2 background traits, but there's a way to get a third, and that's by taking a drawback, a penalty, basically. Way down here at the bottom of the page, under the race traits and extra religion traits, which are deity specific, you have your drawbacks, and these are basically penalties you can take. This guy, I was thinking he'd be kind of a hard guy to get along with, especially if you weren't an elf. He was trained in the army. He grew up in an enclosed elven society, so he's a little bit xenophobic. And so this is the drawback I chose for this guy. -2 on penalty on diplomacy and sense motive checks against basically anybody who's not an elf. So
would that, what about a half elf?
Different race.
All right.
Yeah. So it's pretty much almost all the time you're going to have that penalty. So that's pretty major. There's some other ones in here which are pretty bad too. I won't go into them now, but you can read through them. And some of them are pretty interesting, like lovesick. Whereas your GM actually chooses a person your character is in love with. And at any point, your character is not within, you know, anytime you're away from that person, you take a -2 to your initiative and perception, which would suck.
Yeah, it would.
And then, but you as a character can choose to fall out of love. And then your lovesick turns into this doubt. Where is that at?
Yeah, ridiculous.
The doubt drawback, which really sucks. That's a -4. Anytime you fail a skill or ability check, you take a -4 penalty on that type of skill or ability check for the next hour.
Wow.
Yeah.
So taking one of these drawbacks allows you to choose another.
Yep.
Background.
A third background trait.
Okay.
And to follow up with that indomitable faith, I ended up going with the eyes and ears of the city, which is an Abadar race trait. Abadar is like the god of coin, banks, and that kind of stuff. It's not really a guy that's usually worshipped by elves. And I thought that was pretty interesting. But mainly, and I'll admit, I'm in it for the perception bonuses. Gives you a +1 to your perception checks, and it makes it a class skill. So this one trait alone is going to bump up my perception by 4, since I don't already have perception as a class skill. So those are the ones I chose.
Pretty sneaky, buddy.
Yeah, tricky, huh?
Mm-hmm.
So here, Eyes and Ears of the City, Warrior of Old, Indomitable Faith, and so on. So let me copy and paste some of this stuff to my character sheet. Traits, I'll use these 4 here. So let me put traits. And again, with the sheet, like I said, if I type too much text in one line, it's going to shrink it. That's all right. I can read it. So, not too worried about it. Oops. A little weird. For the most part, these sheets work pretty good, but sometimes you'll get weird glitches. Generally, there's easy workarounds, though. And xenophobic. That's going to be real small. In fact, it does kind of go off the page a little bit. So first I'm just going to put non-elves here to shorten that up a little bit. All right. So to add these to the sheet mechanically, initiative, you get a +2. Initiative is down here. You see it already has my dexterity mod. So 2. Oops. Oh, 23 would be nice. 2. So it makes that a 6 now. Not too bad. Oh, speed of an elf. I forgot to put it in earlier. Base speed is 30. And, let's see here. +1 will saves over here under wills. I'll put that under miscellaneous. Already bumping it up to 2. That's good. And then perception. So I'll make this 2 into a 3. So I have 2 different bonuses to my perception, and now it's a 5, but since it's now a class skill, it's going to jump up to 8. Awesome.
Holy crap.
He's rad. And since this xenophobic works for basically everybody but non-elves, I'm just going to go ahead and put those penalties in here. So -2 to diplomacy, -2 to sense motive. Now, the diplomacy one maybe isn't so bad if you just keep your mouth shut. But sense motive, man, that means this guy's gullible. Like,
yeah.
He's going to fall for a lot of dumb shit if he is allowed to be out on his own and he doesn't have any party members getting his back. And he's going to overpay for shit. He's going to, it's bad news bears. But anyway. So let's keep this moving along so we can get to... sleep. It's starting to get late. where am I at? See, I'm even losing focus. Equipment. That's next. Check. Equipment. All right. Starting gold. All right. Here's where you find equipment. If you go back to the core rulebook, you can click on equipment there, and it'll give you your starting wealth. For a fighter, it's 5 6-sided dice. Multiply that by 10. The average should be 175. Let's roll that real quick.
Oh boy. Let's hope your rolls are just as good as before.
Oh man, yeah. Let's use this one here. So we got a thematic, at least it's the same color as these guys, kind of, right?
Mm-hmm.
All right, what do we got? Oh, yeah, mediocre, I think. 6. All right, so we have 10, 14, multiply that by 10, 140. Well under the average, but that's all right. We'll work with it. So
being in the army doesn't pay that well.
Nope, not at all. Not in the Elven army, anyway. 140 gold pieces. Now, I've already chosen longbow. I don't think, actually, I'll switch this to a short sword because I think eventually he's going to have weapon finesse, which will mean you get a better bonus to his attacks by using a lighter weapon. And then eventually I'll probably get to that Elven Curve Blade, which is another weapon that allows weapon finesse but does a hell of a lot of damage. studded leather armor I chose because this guy wants to get the maximum out of his high dexterity bonus. A little buckler shield, which won't interfere with his archery. And then just basically a fighter's kit. And then you can get creative if you have extra money to spend. So, real quick, getting some of these prices. You can scroll down to weapons, weapon descriptions, and find what you want. Without going into this stuff too much, Everything I want is basically under martial weapons. Short sword is going to be 10 gold pieces. Long sword is going to be... or longbow 75. Probably actually we'll throw a dagger in there. That's only one gold piece. And then we'll go down to the armor and shields. Just keep scrolling.
Gotta buy your arrows too.
Oh,
24 of gold.
That's true. I almost forgot. 5 for a buckler. 25 for a stud leather. And then, yeah, what was the arrows?
20 for one gold piece.
Okay, so I think a quiver can only carry... I think you get the quiver for free with your bow, because nowhere on here does it say, does it have a quiver. But, yeah, so I'll be spending one gold piece on arrows, so... 75 for the bow. 10 for the short sword. 25 for the studded leather armor. 5 for the buckler. Oh, let's not forget the arrows. So already, I am at 116 out of my 140, which means I only have like 24 gold left. And I don't even think that's enough to buy my fighter's kit. Let's find out.
Oh, man.
Go down past the stuff. Oh, yeah. So here's the thing. You can pick and choose. Okay, I need a backpack. I need a bedroll. And this is another place I realized that you can deviate from the core rulebook. Let me show you. If you go down to the ultimate equipment book... or even I think it's in the Advanced Player's Guide too, but Ultimate Equipment has everything. Ultimate Equipment's awesome because it just collects everything up to the point it was published. So you can go click on gear, click on adventuring gear, and you'll see things like Alchemist's Kit, Barbarian's Kit, Bard's Kit. Scroll down to the F's and find the Fighter Kit. Oh yeah, 9 gold pieces. Okay. Pretty good. And that's going to include the necessities. So if you find the description of it. Fighter's kit. Where are we? Backpack, bedroll, belt pouch, flint, steel, iron pot, mess kit, rope, soap, torches, etc., etc. Trail rations, a water skin. All good, important stuff. For 9 gold pieces. Okay, I am within my budget. And that's good to know. So, we can copy this stuff onto the sheet. I'm not going to worry about copying, what I say where I was, 116 plus 9, now I'm at 125, so I have 15 gold left. I'm going to scroll down there and just type in 15 gold carried. You know, this actually adds to your weight of what your character carries. That'll be important later on, and it'll actually add your stuff in here. But for right now, I'm not gonna... okay, let me just write fighter's kit. What you can do is you can go through and copy all that stuff down, and I would recommend it just to save time. I'm not gonna do it right now. Like the bedroll and all the stuff the fighter's kit includes. And I'm just gonna start filling out this weapon stuff. So, studded leather. I should have set up a split screen between the character sheet and the, website for people to see, but you'll just have to take my word for it as far as what this stuff does. Let me see here. I can edit out some of the silence.
Do you want to swap over to the character sheet screen?
Oh, did I not? Oh, geez. See, I am falling asleep here. Did I have the equipment screen? Okay. All right. Sorry, guys. All right, let me scroll back down again and show you where I typed in my 15 gold here. It added to the weight. Just calculates that all automatically, see currency. That's pretty cool. And when you start typing in here, put fighter's kit, you can put all the stuff that includes here if you'd like. Oh, 27 pounds is how much the fighter's kit weighs. See, and now if you scroll back down, you'll see that's added into that as well. My guy's kind of strong, so I'll still be carrying a light load. I have like almost 40 pounds left to work with. Studded leather. Is a plus 3 armor bonus. And this will all get calculated up on top for you. Maximum dexterity of 5, which means if I had a dexterity bonus of 6, one of those wouldn't count, but I don't have to worry about that. An armor check penalty of 1. And I don't have to worry about spell failure and stuff because it's a... I'm not a spellcaster. It's light armor that weighs... What's it weigh here? 20 pounds. And it does not restrict my movement. And I could have gone with the heavy armor. In fact, even like a scale mail or a hide armor, I'd still be able to get my plus 4 maximum dexterity. And I'd get one more armor bonus, but then my armor check penalty would go up, which I'll explain shortly. As well as the weight, as well as the it would affect his speed. So I'm not messing with all that stuff. Buckler, which is just a small little round shield you hold up that attaches to your forearm. That's nice. It gives you one more AC for one penalty to your armor bonus. And then S for shield. And that doesn't weigh much either. That's, in fact, 5 pounds. So we're still doing good. Type in longbow. I'm just going to add the weight of a longbow for right now, which is 3 pounds. Arrows. The only reason I'm putting it on its own line, because it also weighs 3 pounds. Just because I wanted to calculate the weight for me. Short sword. Is 2 pounds. Alright, so I'm not going to worry about typing this stuff in for attack modifiers, because that'll be up top. Although, it's kind of good reference for you sometimes. But a longbow does 1d8 damage. Yeah. 1d8 damage. It does a critical hit on 20s only, but it does 3 times the damage if you do hit. The range is 100 feet. And it's piercing damage. Alright?
Mm-hmm.
The short... Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. The short sword is a 1d6. And it crits on a 19 or a 20. Has a bigger range, but it's just a times 2. And that also is just piercing damage. Alright, so I got that stuff added in. Now you'll see the weight all added up. Scroll down. So now my guy's weight has about 60 pounds. He has a little bit of room before he moves into medium load. That'll affect your speed possibly and that kind of, and some of the things you can do. The other thing we'll look at real quick is your AC bonus. So 4 and 1. You would add that to your dexterity to get your AC, which the sheet does so nice, does it for me. It also figures out your touch and your flat foot AC, which your game master will explain when you need to know those numbers. And the other thing that it does, you saw where I was talking about the armor check penalty. It's a 1 for the armor and a 1 for the shield. It calculates it automatically for you. So look, climb... maybe I'm supposed to actually type -1. Yeah, alright, there we go. See, that climb was a 6, and it dropped it down to a 4, because it's taken into effect that penalty. It doesn't tell you that it's doing it, but it obviously does, because 3 plus 2 plus 1 does not equal 4. So,
nope.
So you'll see a lot of your numbers have dropped down once you start adding armor in and stuff. It's kind of disappointing, but, you know. Just the way it is, man. And for the most part, I think our sheet is basically done. So now we can start filling in some of this other stuff. Let's look at what we have going on here. Equipment. Got our ACs figured out. The saves are automatically calculated. Initiative is automatically calculated. Attacks are automatically calculated. Let's show you that here. So here are your saves. They're already figured out for you, like the AC. Your melee attack is +3. Your range attacks are +5. Like, it does all the math for you. And you can improve these things with feats. Like, so if I do get within range of somebody within 30 feet, I'll change that 5 to a 6 when I roll my dice. But, you know, it's all good to go. There is one more important thing. And that is our favored class bonus. Now, favored class is a fighter, like I said. Well, anytime you take a new level in your favored class, you get to choose either between a skill point or a hit point. With this guy, I'm actually going to take a skill. If you took a hit point and you added it here, you'll see that the 1 adds your 12 is your maximum to a 13. I'm not going to do that. So I'm actually going to make this skill 5 instead, because I'm going to add it to that. So now I have one more skill to play with. And like I was saying earlier, I think I'll take sleight of hand, because I think it'd be, I might want to, you never know, man. I mean, you might want to keep a dagger hidden or something. It might come in handy. Plus, I couldn't do it before, but now I got an opportunity to. So, and there you go. Now, if you want, you can go into your physical characteristics. Equipment, AC, hit points, all that's taken care of. Initiative, attacks, favorite class bonus. Physical characteristics, and then we'll talk about alignment, deity, and stuff real quick. But all this is filling out this stuff, and this is not important to the actual mechanics of the game. But this guy, medium. If you look at my artwork, he's just probably like a, you know, 5'11" or something. And there's actually you can actually roll for these. It depends if your game master wants to let you pick and choose your own weight and stuff. There's a place that allows you to do that. If you go to the, where is that, Jared? Do you know where that is?
No. Is it? It's not. Is it under races?
No, here it is. I found it. Under additional rules in the core rulebook. So you scroll down and you'll find age. You can choose a random starting age for an elf. They don't reach adulthood until they're 110 years old. So for a fighter, you go 110 and you add 6d6 to that. You know what? Let's just do that. Let's roll it. Let's roll.
Well, you better show us, man.
All right.
I just heard the zip.
6. Let's see. 10, 20, 4. So what did I say? 110 plus
34. 110 was the start.
So this guy's 134 years old. He's just starting out on his own. He's a young elf. since I'm right here, let me type in. This guy's chaotic good. He's always trying to do the right thing no matter what the cost, basically. Elves commonly are chaotic good according to Pathfinder mythology, but it's not important. And I already know my guy's deity is Abadar, out of character for him. Homeland, background, occupation. I mean, he's always just been a soldier. As far as homeland, it depends on where the campaign takes place, and you have to ask your GM about that. Anyway, so back to the other random physical characteristics. If your guy is really old, you can actually take penalties. Height and weight. So for an elf, base height is 5'4". Base weight is 100. So what you do is you roll 2d8 and add it to your as inches to figure out your character's random starting height. And you take that same number, multiply it by 3, and add it to the 100. So let's roll this real quick. I don't think I might not take time to edit out all these curse words. It might just be too much trouble.
It hasn't been too bad, man.
Not too bad. Okay, so he's tall, man. Look at that.
Yeah, he is.
14.
Look at those legs on that drawing, man. That guy's got some sticks.
That's true. That's true. So what's it say on the chart? 14 plus 5'4". So that, geez, 6'4". That'd be 6'6". He's like Michael Jordan height. That's crazy. And then multiply that 14 by 3. So what's that? 23, I can't do math right now. 42. But he's only 142 pounds.
Tall and skinny.
Yes, sir. That is a trip. All right, so let's change this number here. I'm glad I rolled that because that gives him his own, that really gives him some unique characteristic there. What did I say? 146? 142?
142.
And look, it's pounds, not kilograms. Come on. The recording drawing, he's got dark brown hair. Was that black or brown? Dark brown, let's say. Yeah, let's call it black. And I don't think I can see an eye color there. I think he's a wood elf. He's got black eyes too, or dark brown. And pale skin. All right, covered in tattoos and stuff. So our dude is ready. So thanks for listening. I mean, you can come up with your own backstories. I've kind of explained my guys' backstories as we went along. There should be a link if you follow. I'll update that page I was referencing, this one. I'll put a link to Theron Ensier's first level fighter character sheet. Put it probably right down here under the other links. And enjoy. Like, anytime, feel free to contact me if you have a question. Here's some places. If you you can look up Jared on Twitter at Wooly Toots, spelled just like it sounds. And yep. I think it's a natural, man, that you should do tutorials. It's in your, I mean, TOOTS, but
yeah, hey, Wooly Tutorials.
Thanks. That's a thumbs up. All right, dude. Happy rolling. Happy rolling, peeps.
Yeah, guys. Enjoy Pathfinder.
Yeah, good to go, man. Thanks, dude, for joining me.
Yeah, man. Hopefully a lot of people use your character and get him killed.
Yeah. Well, rename him. I figured I'd do that.
Yeah, you'll never know.